afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining us. So I'd like to start by showing you this photograph that was made last year in Astana, the capital city of Kazakhstan. So here, Mr. Talgat Shaltaev, a lawyer, covered the statue with a big scarf. So he did so because he thought that it is a shame for a Kazakh girl, even if it's a bronze statue, to look sexy. And this action of his received a lot of support from society. And this example shows us that shame is a very important element of the Kazakh culture. So in Kazakh language, the word shame is yat, and this is written on the chest of this comic character that we have now, whose name is Yatmen. So shame is not only a part of Kazakh culture, but it is also a part of the Soviet legacy, when it was not acceptable to discuss sex openly. And overall, youth and teenagers are seen as children in Kazakhstan, and children are not supposed to have sex. And if they don't have sex, then there is no place for sexuality education in our schools, and that's why we don't have it in the formal curriculum. By sexuality education, I mean providing age-appropriate and medically proven information on sexuality, covering various topics like abstinence, decision-making, human development, relationships, contraception, and prevention of diseases, and many other topics. And in my research project, my aim was to understand how we can normalize sexuality education and make it culturally acceptable. Because what we have right now is this informal abstinence-only policy in which sex before marriage is not acceptable. Well, the reality tells us a different story. So about 10,000 teenage girls give birth every year in Kazakhstan. And 10,000 is a huge number, and it screams about sexual illiteracy of Kazakhstani youth. So a typical case is that when a young girl comes from a rural area to an urban area to study in a university, and then she gets pregnant. And she's afraid of going back to her family with a child, so she abandons that child. And in these pictures, you can see places where those babies are found, like almost every month we have those news. So those are trash bins and public toilets and just roadside. So teenage pregnancies are not the only problem that result from lack of sexual literacy among youth. There are also a high spread of sexually transmitted infections and teenage abortions and early marriages. So even if that girl doesn't abandon the baby and gets married, she has less chances for a better future because she drops out of school and rarely goes back to her studies. And without the proper education, she has less chances she's less able to provide for herself in the future. So this abstinence-only policy may seem reasonable, but it doesn't actually work. And what we have as a result of it is that there is no sexuality education in schools, and there are a lot of state programs that mention reproductive health of youth, but none of them suggests any specific actions. And the main actors here are now international organizations. The biggest project is done by United Nations Fund for Populations Activity. They conduct sexuality education for vocational schools, and this project runs already in three regions of Kazakhstan, and it is very successful. And though it is a very big and huge step forward, it still has some flaws. For example, in the textbook of that program, there are interactive games where girls are taught that they are responsible for how boys and men treat them. Also, many projects of international organizations focus on girls and women's reproductive health, while boys and men make up half of the population, and of course they have to take care of their reproductive health as well. So in my research project, I conducted an anonymous survey of Kazakhstani youth just to know their opinions and their experiences. And one of the very important observations that I found is that even if young people are not sexually active, they still want to be sexually literate. So I will just read you one quote from my respondent. She's a schoolgirl. So she says that there are no materials in Kazakh language. I don't know how to protect myself from diseases, and they don't teach us at school. So among other main conclusions of my survey is that youth need and want to know more. And very often they expect to learn from their parents. But out of 57 of my respondents, in fact, only one received some sort of information about sex from one of his parents. Parents are ashamed and afraid of talking about sex with their children, and the kids don't have sexuality education in schools. So in these circumstances, the only option for them is internet. Well, there are several problems with internet resources. The first one is that not all resources provide reliable information. Half of my respondents encountered pornography in some way while they were trying to find answers to their questions. The second problem is that almost all the resources are either in Russian or in English, and they are not from Kazakhstan, which means that they don't take into account the cultural context of our youth. And the third problem is that there are no online resources in Kazakh language at all. So, and this is a big problem actually, because most of those teenage pregnancies take place in the southern regions of Kazakhstan. Those are most densely populated, and there the main language that people speak there is Kazakh. So here I just wanted to show you how we lack those online platforms. I compared two Instagram accounts from Kyrgyzstan and from Kazakhstan that were made by and for young wives, the so-called killings. So in Kyrgyz account, you can see there's a lot of discussion going on. So a young woman asks a question about some family issue or a sexual issue, and then other women try to help her, give her advice, and support her. While in Kazakh Instagram, there are only food recipes. I really tried to find a similar resource in Kazakh language or in Russian language, but from Kazakhstan, but I couldn't. Even this Kelin app, the application that was created specifically for those young wives, it has a lot of harassment and bullying against those women who ask questions from, and this bullying is coming from women and men. I don't even know why what men are doing there. despite the fact that respondents of my survey come from different parts of Kazakhstan, and despite the fact that they speak different languages, they all agreed that sexuality education empowers youth to act more responsibly and to postpone their sexual activity. And the second point that everybody agreed on is that sexuality education needs to focus both on girls and boys equally. And the third point is that it needs to have easy access and be youth-friendly so that young people could find answers to their questions easily. And you can see that Mr. Yatman, the big scarf suits him very well as well. So this man is very popular in Kazakhstan. So I provided several policy recommendations based on my survey. And the first one, and the biggest one, is of course that we need to introduce sexuality education into our school curriculum. It is a very challenging and a long process, and the first easier step could be to survey our high school students just to know their knowledge gaps and what they think about sexuality education and in which form they would like to have it. The second recommendation is that we need to make healthcare service providers youth-friendly. An easy action here could be to install vending machines with condoms. This will exclude this personal embarrassing experience for teenagers to go and buy condoms in a drugstore, because I know of cases when a teenage boy goes to a drugstore and he wants to buy a condom and a pharmacist tells him, you are too young, come back when you are 18. So what this teenage boy does, of course, this probably will not stop him from having sex, but he will do it without a condom. The third recommendation is that we need to raise awareness among parents and the general population. We need to spread the message what sexuality education is about, and that it is not about corrupting innocent minds of children, but it is about teaching them that if they choose to engage in sex, they should be able to do it safely. An easy way to start it is to distribute informational pamphlets in clinics or in hospitals. And the last recommendation is that as a society, we can already start educating our young people right now. And one way to do that is to create our own online platforms that would take into account our local cultural context. And that is why I came up with my own project, and now I'm working on development of this website that I named Yatemez, which means no shame in Kazakh language. And in this, in a team with an IT specialist and a designer, we created this prototype, and I already bought the domain. So here young people will be able not only to find some useful information, scientifically proven information about reproductive health and other issues, they will also be able to share their own experiences and to learn from their peers, just to understand that it is normal to have questions and some embarrassing experiences and that it is okay. And there will also be some interactive games and quests for young people to practice their decision-making skills. So the bottom line message of my website is that it is not a shame to learn about sexual and reproductive health. Thank you very much.